It's Saturday morning, just after 9, and that means it's time for the Bendigo Bank Footy Show. In a tradition that dates back 30 years, created by the legend, the doyen, and the voice of local footy, Andrew Topun Kelly, it's time to get off the bench, pull up the socks, and pay attention, because here's your host, Lockie Kelly.
Hello and welcome to the Division 2 Bendigo Bank Footy Show here on a lovely Saturday morning. Pleasure to have Simon McAvoy here joining us again.
G'day Locke and Blackers.
And of course Tony Blackford.
Yeah, it's good, slick. It's good to be here, mate. I've just got out of the shower and it is one of those good Saturdays, Locke. It's going to be overcast day, but gee, no wind. Wowee.
Which is...
Been a while since we've had no wind.
No, it is a bit of a change over the last couple of weeks, that's for sure. It's been gale force winds.
It's just lucky that the footy hasn't been played some of these midweek days we've had lately. Some of the wind gusts have been amazing.
Yeah, it's been pretty full on, that's for sure. Last week, boys, we had a pretty interesting round. Obviously, Tyab nearly got the job done over Germana.
You know, their form's wonderful, isn't it? And, you know, like, take nothing away. It was obviously, Germana had to dig really deep, but... they will win a couple more on the way home.
Well, I mean, we speak about Langmore and obviously beating Hastings through the week. You know, that for them and for most people think, you know, now from now on they've got an easy run coming home. After beating Hastings, it should be an easy run. But going to Tyab today. Mm, they've got Corey McKernan and Wayne Carey down there today for a sportsman's lunch. It's going to be a very tough task.
Yeah, I was speaking to Ricky Johnson, the Dramana coach, last week, and he was a big rap for Tyab. He says they've really made good inroads, and he says it's great for footy that they've improved the way they have.
So, it's great for the competition, yeah. Simon, and they're playing one-on-one football all over the ground, and they're a very competitive unit.
That they are. They're such a young side as well. There's plenty of youth that really want to drive that club.
Yeah, talking to Braids, and they've re-signed a lot of guys early, which is great, and it just gives them stability, and hopefully they can recruit a few more people in the off-season.
Yeah, hopefully. Obviously, they've come out and said that they've got that marquee player lined up as well for early next year as well, which is positive signs for Tyab. It's good to see that things are definitely going in the right direction for them, that's for sure. Boys, we'll have a look at the ladder straight up. Germana obviously sitting on top. They got another win there. 2.5 games clear at the moment of Red Hill.
10 points clear. Yeah. But it comes down today. Like, I think that these two sides will play each other another 3 times before the end of the year, Lock.
Yeah, I can agree with that, that's for sure. From what I saw of Red Hill last weekend, wasn't super impressive. Obviously, their foot skills were poor. It wasn't too bad a day up on the hill. There was a lot of perceived pressure around. They could have been a lot better. They strung things together better in the second half. There's no doubt about that. But of course, then you look at Coringa losing Justin Farrelly and David Hurst in the first half, so they only had 2 rotations. So you question, you know, was that because they, you know, had those lesser players that they took off?
Gee, Farrelly can't take a trick, can he? Like
poor fella.
He had a pretty good pre-season, or especially Todd as well. So Justin comes back and he breaks down straight away.
Yeah, first game. We initially thought it was a rib injury. He looked to be holding his ribs pretty heavily, but we had a chat to Dunny through half time and he said that Farrelly felt like he tore something. Simon, you know more on that. You had a chat to Dunny through the week.
Yeah, Dunny said he did a rib cartilage. So, yeah, he'll be back certainly before the end of the season, and yeah. So will Bullet Hurst. He'll be back. He'll probably miss a week, and he's had some stitches in his.
What about Goodall? While you're on career?
Yeah, Goodall. He won't play today, but he'll play more than likely next week, and so too will Todd Farrelly. He's in the same basket as well. So yeah,
and Jake Kelly. You mentioned him last week. He said he was on the brink.
Jake Kelly, he's training well. He's pulling up a little bit sore. He broke his ankle, so he's on the comeback trail. Hasn't played a game this year, but he's certainly going to play before the end of the season, and that's going to be a big inclusion for Coringa.
The only thing I say about that is it's wonderful that these guys are going to be available, but they're all going to be underprepared, and you can only take 1 or 2 guys that are underdone. Goodall and Farrelly are both slow blokes and lumberers. So
you can get away with Goodall, though, being a ruckman.
Oh, he needs to play.
Yeah.
He needs to play to give them first use.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that, because as soon as Farrelly went down on the weekend, it meant Duncan Proud went into the ruck and they lost a centre-half back.
It affects their whole structure, doesn't it?
Yeah, it really does. They throw them a lot.
And don't write off Aaron Paxton from coming back. You know, he's probably been their best player all year. He has had a break from footy over the last few weeks, but...
So what's he come back and apologise, has
he? Well, hey, look, he...
well, his brother played in the ones on the weekend, so there's obviously not too much of a problem with...
Look, don't discount him coming back. So, you know, he's probably had a good think about things. And, look, there's a possible premiership there, and he's a real Coringle person. So let's hope he can come back and play a big part for them.
Keep posted on that one. Yeah. That might be a comeback, which will be... I mean, that's super handy for me if I can get that, because... Yep. It really structures them up a lot better, especially if they lose a ruckman again and Duncan Proud has to go in the ruck. But then you look at Red Hill.
If they can get Todd Farrelly back, his early season form was outstanding as a key defender.
Yeah, exactly right. I mean, mate, you look at their side last week, even the side that we saw against Langmoreland a few weeks ago, probably a month ago now, they were missing a lot. They got some of those players back, but then they've lost a couple again. You know, Brendan Dunn didn't play on the weekend. Matt Stanley didn't play on the weekend. There's some quality players in that.
Still didn't have Stanley either.
No, Stanley didn't play either. There's a lot of quality. I mean, if they can get that full 22 back, then they're definitely going to be a threat come finals.
Yeah, they just need
whether
to get
they're underprepared
work
or not
into their legs and all that.
Yeah, that's for sure. I mean, you look at Red Hill. Hughes didn't play the best game of footy we've seen him play. Irving barely touched it, mate. Played for the last three quarters, just played as a key forward, didn't go near the midfield. So whether there's an injury there, I'm not sure, or whether they're just icing the game.
So the bloke who played on Irving and Hughes obviously did good jobs, because they obviously didn't have Paxton, Todd Farrelly, or Duncan Proud on any of those three.
Yeah, I thought Dylan Gregson was brilliant on Irving.
Oh, yeah.
He just wore him like a glove, didn't give him any opportunity. They're quite similar body-wise, so he matched up really well. And Duncan Proud had the early job on Hughes and did well as well. I can't remember who went to...
Well, Hughes only kicked one and Chris only kicked one as well.
Yeah, so, I mean, you look at that, if you're Red Hill and you say we didn't play close to our best footy and still got the job done by 40 points.
Oh, especially at home.
Yeah, so, I mean, next week shapes up to be... Oh, sorry, today shapes up to be a really good contest. Yeah.
It's funny, it's a long season and, you know, Red Hill have been up for so long, so has Dramana, and, you know, I think Ricky Johnson admitted last week that Dramana were a bit flat. I mean, they've got top spots sewn up. What are they playing for? They're just waiting for finals, really. So Ricky Johnson actually said that today's game is exactly what Dramana need. Top of the table clash, finals sort of atmosphere and feel. So bring it on.
And especially, say, five or six weeks ago, Dramana started really well. They got off to an 8-goal lead against Red Hill, and then I put their cue in the rack or whatever, and Red Hill were able to overrun them. Mm. That was on the Queen's birthday weekend. So I think that today shapes up to be a cracking game.
Yeah, it really does. I think what's going to get Dramana over the line is just how well they play that smaller ground at Dramana. I think from what I saw on the weekend of Red Hill's footy, the way they play their best footy is by spreading wide and switching. It's pretty tough to do on a small ground.
Yeah.
So I think Dramana might probably get the job done.
Good clash, isn't it? So that was Red Hill's turning point when they came from behind and beat Dramana earlier in the season. Both sides since are undefeated. They haven't lost a game. So it's going to be a cracking game today.
Mm. Yeah, well, I mean, you touched on it before, Blackers. They're probably going to play each other another at least three times.
I think today...
And another two.
Yeah,
I can agree with that. I think that's probably going to be the grand final for me if Coringle can't put a good side together. And I think that might be the teams that play off in the grand final. I'm doing the Michael Voss early crow. But for me, from both sides, seeing both sides, I think they're definitely the best sides that I've seen all year, that's for sure. We'll then go to Dramana Tyabe. We've already slightly touched on that one. Dramana obviously kicked two late goals through Ethan Johnston after Tyabe hit the front later on in the last and got the job done. But certainly didn't do it too easy.
Yeah, they got a bit of a scare down there on the weekend. And like you said, Simon, it's very hard to keep blokes up and their morale all the time. And it's a game that they probably think in their back of their mind, we're going to win today.
Mm.
And they really had to scrap hard. It's credit to Tyabe.
Yeah, as we touched on, it's absolute credit for Tyabe. There's some serious positives going on at that club, that's for sure. There's no doubt about that.
Absolutely, yeah. No, it's a big day for Tyabe, yeah, with Wayne Carey and that there today, so it's going to be fantastic. But they're a club on the rise, there's no doubt about it, the Abbeys.
That's for sure. We'll go to Chelsea. Chelsea hosted Somerville. and had a massive win. They kicked 19-13, 127 to Somerville's 10-16, 76. Got the job done well and truly. Curtis Bywater kicking another five and getting himself...
He's been very consistent, like, hasn't he?
He has. He's had a massive year, yeah. That's for sure. He's put himself within two goals of Jesse Murphy on the goal-kicking table, yeah. And really has been vital in Chelsea's year.
Oh, I think he has. He really straightens them up, and James Brain came back last week, and yeah, there's probably a couple more to come back into that side, but they're not far off being full strength now.
Yeah,
Chelsea.
Yeah, that's right. And Reid Crowe, the recruit from Shepparton United, he's been really good for them over the last 2 months. He was very good last week, and Matt Ponton continues to play really good footy, and Todd Gardner, very talented player. So
Dave Willard had a good game as yep. well on the weekend, which yeah, is good to see.
That's good old head, isn't it? Dave, and he bobs up every now and then for a couple of good games.
Yeah, he's got that X factor, hasn't he? He's a very talented guy, so yeah, could be really handy come September or late August.
Well, yeah, he knows finals footy, that's for
yeah,
sure.
He certainly
there's no doubt
does.
About that. He's like you said, he's got that old head. And Lang Warren Hastings, boys, this was probably one of the matches that we're going to be watching closely for the Saturday. Lang Warren had to win to keep themselves in contention to get that fifth spot, and did convincingly. 13-12-90 to Hastings, 11-3-69. Lang Warren just probably could have won by a fair bit more. Unfortunately, couldn't get the scoreboard rolling, but did the job and needed to.
I think, boys, Hastings are going to struggle to win another game. I think they play...
They host Coringle this week.
Coringle. And then they've got Redhill. And then they've got Chelsea, I think.
Yeah, I think you might be right.
I don't think they'll win another game. They'll lose their last four games.
And then Warren play Tyab this week. Pearsdale the next, and Sammy last round.
Yeah.
So it's going to be a real interesting battle for
it's
that.
It's really interesting, isn't it? It's yeah, Lang Warren's got a favourable draw, so
it's a game and a half separating them. So yeah. Hastings are.
So I just at this stage, I think that Hastings would not start favourite in any of those games.
No, I can agree with that. I can certainly agree with that.
Good test for the Blues, isn't it? Really, really good test. And Ricky Ferraro. So yeah, we'll see how they get along.
Yeah, that's for sure. We'll then go to Pearsdale Crib Point. We said that this was going to be a scrap of a game. Quite high scoring for me. I was quite taken aback by the scoreline. 16-10-106-14-13-97. Pearsdale just scraping over the line by 9 points there, but must have been a brilliant contest.
Yeah, and especially when it's free-flowing like that, like, and you're kicking multiple goals, doesn't matter the quality of the teams, that's still a good game to watch, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly right. That's what you want in those, especially in those kinds of games. You want that contest.
Yeah, from what I'm told, under-19 player Luke Daniel had an absolute cracking game last week. He played on the wing and on the ball and kicked 3 goals and was outstanding. So really positive signs there.
Is he for Pearsdale?
Yeah, he's a Pearsdale boy. Yeah. So, and also Luke Delmo also starred.
Yeah.
He's had a terrific season.
He has had a good year, Delmo.
It was a pretty handy player to have come back. From the Stingrays program, obviously Josh Bateman came back to Jemana, and he came back to Pearsdale, so he's a very handy player to have.
Yep. And David Hussey and Dan Hyden and Jaron Ostrom continues to play. His name keeps bombing up in Pearsdale's best players, so
yeah,
good
Jaron
on him.
Jaron Ostrom, that's good. Yeah, yep. That's, I mean, you name those kids, that's an average age of about 22 and younger, so that's brilliant for Pearsdale. I guess if they can keep breeding those younger kids to come through, then
any other news coming out of Pearsdale side?
Okay, so Lee Stewart, there's no news on the coaching there, but he just reckons they need some senior recruits. Absolute, that's crucial. They get senior players to come in,
yeah,
because that's what they're lacking. They're very young. They've got a very talented young group. Lee says one of the best young groups around, but they just need some guidance on the field.
There's some rumours floating around that something happened last week.
Yeah, I heard something.
Training track.
There was a bit of an altercation or something.
Just between a couple of senior players.
Yeah, I don't know exactly what happened, but maybe we can find out a bit more scoop, eh?
Dig into that. Because, I heard there was certainly something that happened on, and I'm not going to state anything that's not factual, but, yeah, rumours that something certainly happened on a Tuesday night before training. We'll keep our eyes posted on that one, that's for sure. But Crib Point boys, obviously, good to see them get, you know, I mean, and obviously it's a bottom of the table clash, but good to see them kind of put a score on the board and be competitive.
Yeah, I think it was good. And I think efforts like that would go a long way to be more competitive in a lot of other games.
Well, speaking of Nathan Johns during the week, he said it was their best performance all season. They've had one win, but he said last week's effort was their best effort all season.
Where's he at, Simon?
He's really upbeat. You know, he's there for 3 years, so this is his first year. So he's in for the long haul. He's really positive. He says Crew Point recruited heavily in pre-season, but all those recruits, a lot of them have been injured, so they haven't really made an impact. It's been the young kids. I think he said the average age in the seniors is 21.9 years, which is pretty young. Yeah, so he says they need recruits, but he's upbeat. He says the last 3 weeks they've got to win back respect of the competition, so a good challenge for Crew Point.
Well, and you'd hope that's the effort they put on the park for the next 3 weeks. I mean, obviously, for them, you'd probably think that they've put in the extra effort knowing that Pearstown aren't a great side either and that they might be a sniff. Even if they're coming up against the Red Hill, then they've really got to put
and they've got another opportunity in Devon this week. So
yeah, exactly right.
I think Devon are playing some good footy at the moment.
Well, Pearstall beat Devon Meadows. That was their only... Crew Point beat Devon Meadows. So that was their only win. So here they are again. They meet them again. You never know.
Exactly right. And then we'll go to... Touching on Devon Meadows game, they were hosted by Rye on the weekend. Rye kicked 9-16-70 to Devon Meadows 11-73. Devon Meadows just kicking a bit more straighter on the day and getting the job done by 3 points.
They've had some good form lately, Locke, haven't they, Devon? I think that's 2 or 3 in a row that they've... Well, 3 out of 4.
I reckon Glenn Mickey might want to come back in on the show. He's ever since the interview we had with him, he's taken off.
And the full forward keeps kicking goals. Theo, he's gone past 50 goals now for the season, been a really good player this season. So,
So he and Fletcher have been good recruits for their club.
Yeah, they have, massive recruits. Obviously, only 5 goals behind Jesse Murphy now, Theo. So he's Neil Gustafson's favourite man. He's an absolute Adonis, as in Michael Voss's words.
The old great Neil on Saturday night. So he had a beer in one hand, he had a party pie in the other, and it was hard for him to talk to me, eat and drink at the same time.
I'm sure he managed pretty well. I reckon he's probably used to that, Neil Gustafson. Used to the party pie and frothy in one hand, that's for sure. There's no doubt about that. One of our PFM's finest. Boys, Red Hill, Coringle, obviously the last game we did last week, and we touched on that, so we don't need to touch on that, but we'll run over the score. 11-11-77 to Coringle's 5-7-37. They were just unfortunate. Coringle lost 2 players in that first half of footy, which really damaged them going into the second half, and Red Hill just ended up running over the top. It was a pretty scrappy game for my thoughts, considering the weather was pretty good up on the hill, but... Red Hill obviously with a big task this week, that's for sure. We'll go to a short break, we'll come back to you with today's games. You're listening to RPP, the voice of Peninsula Football.
Here at Bendigo Community Bank branches, we support local footy.
Local teams. And all our community champions.
Bendigo Bank and RPFM. Bringing local footy to the community.
Watch our live telecast on RPFM. It's live and it's local.
Hi, I'm Mason Lockett. Finally bringing the under-19 weekly report over to the Div 2 footy show. Starting from this round onwards, I'll be giving a quick rundown from the round played the week before and the round coming up this week, really. Let's jump straight into it and looking into this week's games. Kicking us off this week, we have Langwarrin versus Tyabb. Looking back at the past couple rounds, Langy have been in really good form. And they've just brought back one of their, looks to be star players, Nathan Allen, who came out and kicked 8 goals to them last game. And yeah, you heard that right, 8 goals. That's quite a lot. So I'm betting Nathan and the rest of Langwarrin are looking to come out and put on another big show and have a big win over Tyabb, who have only had 1 win in the past, so it can't be that hard to beat them. Next up, we have Chelsea versus Pearstall. With both these teams coming with big losses, I can see them all going back to the track and have a real big night of training ahead of them. It could really go any way for both these teams, with Chelsea being 10th on the ladder and Pearstall being 9th. It'll be tough for both of them, but with Chelsea having the home advantage, it'll be really close, but I reckon they can come out and steal the win. Next up, we have Somerville versus Rye. This is the real blockbuster match of the week, with both teams shaping up, looking like they're going to be playing finals. With Rye being 3rd, I really think they'll come out on top compared to Somerville's 5th on the ladder. But really, anything can happen, and some of them are going to be wanting to come out and prove they can be a real contender for the finals. So they're going to have everything it takes and chuck it towards Ryder, see if they can come out and top and prove who they actually are. Next up, we have Hastings versus Coringle. With Hastings coming off a huge 120-point loss to Langwarrin, I can't really see them taking out Coringle, with them being second on the ladder. It's going to be a real tough game for them. But wouldn't it be amazing if Hastings come out and actually knock off second on the ladder? That's going to be something to report on next week. We'll just see what happens, and hopefully I have an amazing story to come back with you guys next week. Next up, we have Devon Meadows versus Crib Point. With Devon Meadows having a really tough year, I can see Crib Point coming out and just really wanting to boost their percentage going into finals. When we look back at both these teams playing last time, Devon Meadows didn't score, so I'm guessing their goal for this game is to at least put something on the scoreboard and prove they can be a bit of a challenge towards one of the top sides in the cup. That's it from me on the Under-19s Weekly Report. Be sure to get down 10 a.m. Saturday morning to support your team's next generation. Now to cross back to Lockie and the boys, and be sure to stick around for Div 1 Footy Show, where you'll be seeing my Under-19s report.
Hello and welcome back to the Bendigo Bank Division 2 Football Show, where we're going to go straight into today's games. Obviously, Tyre Boys hosting Langwarrin. The Duck, Wayne Carey and big Corey McKernan down there today. Tyab in some brilliant form. Langwarrin pretty much have to win every game from here on in to be a sniff of making that fifth spot. Should be an absolute cracker of a contest.
What sort of a day have they got down there? Why have McKernan and Carey come in?
I think they're appearing tonight. I think it's a night thing.
Oh, night,
sportsman's
sorry.
Night. Yeah, but what a coup to have those two.
Oh, 100%.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's so massive to have. I mean, it's awesome for the club.
And Aaron Pacey's done an amazing job with this club. I think that he's rallied around. He brought some recruits with him. Yes, probably from lower competitions. It was the Southern, wasn't it?
Yeah, the Southern Footy League, Sky Football Club, yeah.
So, but they've been able to gel together. Yes, they got a few injuries early on in the season. Probably should have had that scalp of Hastings. I still think that they would kick themselves for that. But that they, you know, with that, those sort of occasions, they learn a lot.
Yeah, exactly right. I mean, to put it up to a rampant Dramana last week is absolutely massive. They hit the front in the last quarter. Unfortunately for them, Dramana just dug a little bit deeper and got a couple of goals. But a massive opportunity for them today, again, to get another win on the board.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting because last time Langy and Tyab met, I think Langy won by 14 goals.
They got off to a great start that day. They blew them away early.
But, you know, Tyab's a very different team. Or they're a much more confident team now. So it's going to be interesting to see how much, inroads they've made since that last meeting, so it'll be a good contest.
And the last time they played Dramana at Tyab, they were right in that game as well. They beat Chelsea a couple of weeks ago. They nearly ran over the top of, they ran out of legs against Hastings. Their form's been great.
That has. I mean, I was speaking to a couple of the Langwarrin boys through the week, and they said that well and truly Tyab, they played earlier in the year, was the worst team they've played all year. So coming into this week is going to be a big shock for them. I mean, obviously, they'll be looking at the form they've had and watching game time videos.
Yeah.
And today's going to be a massive task for Langwarrin, especially at Tyab.
Yeah, I think Tyab will take it right up to them. And I wouldn't be surprised if they won. But I think that Langwarrin, as a club, have got too much to lose. They've got too much in front of them. And they need to get over the line. They just can't sit on their heels and think about what happened last week. They've got to think about this week. And
I think they might have a few players coming back
again
today as well. I know that Blake McCormack didn't play again last
Patterson
week.
Patterson didn't play.
Shane Patterson didn't play. Nick Hamill didn't play. You know, there's a centre-half back, a half-back and a tagging midfielder. So if they can get those back, massive for the club coming home, that's for sure, especially a day like today against Tyab.
Yeah, you would have, earlier in the season, you would have penciled in a certain win for Langwarrin, but no, not now. Things have changed. But, you know, Jet Murphy kicked 6 goals against Tyab last time they met, so he's obviously a key today. Blake Peach played well against them last time, and so did Nick Tudnham. So these guys, they'll be crucial figures today, I reckon.
Well, you look at, you know, how they performed against Hastings. They knew that the season was on the line, and they had a lot of players step up and play their roles, and they'll be looking to do the exact same today, that's for sure. Tyab obviously will want to win at home, especially going into the night with Wayne Carey and Corey McKernan.
Yeah, to make it a really special night. So, look, I'm going to stick with Lange. I think that Lange have got too much to lose.
Yeah, I'm with you as well, Blackers. I think Lange won't. In a real close one, I think it'll be no more than 3 goals at the end of the day. I think Tyab are going to stick it right up to him, but I think Langmore might just have more to play for at the end of the day.
It'll be a hard ask for him down there today.
It will. They'll be sore. That's for sure.
Unless Tyab can get Wayne Carey to play, I'll tip Langmore, I think.
Geez, wouldn't that be brilliant to see the big duck getting around at full forward? We'll then go to Chelsea, boys. Chelsea hosting Pearcedale. You'd hope that Chelsea can really get another big win on the board going into getting closer and closer to finals with Pearcedale. Coming off a win, but they've had a pretty disappointing year. Curtis Bywater obviously absolutely dominating this year, having the best year he's had, that's for sure, and only 2 goals away from Jesse Murphy up the top of the ladder. So he'll want to do something pretty special for his team. And as Simon touched on, through last week's results, they've got so many players that are stepping up and performing on a frequent basis with James Brayan and Todd Gardner, Matty Pontem playing some good footy. So, you know, they're becoming a serious threat come finals time.
He's going to be hard to match up on today. Really nice day for football and all that sort of stuff. He's big, strong body. The last few weeks, like, it's been probably a forward's nightmare.
Yeah.
With that breeze. And so, anyway, it's a good day for a forward today. So, given that opportunity, one out, and I think that he'll kick a bag today.
Do you reckon? Yeah. Well, yeah, Curtis, he kicked 5 against the last time when Chelsea beat Pearcedale. Chelsea led at three-quarter time the last time they met. Pearcedale led by a point at three-quarter time, but were overrun. Chelsea won by 28 points. Curtis Bywater kicked 5 that day. Geez, kicked some bags of 5, hasn't he?
He's kicked a lot of fives, yeah.
So, yeah, he's obviously a key figure today, but I know Pearcedale are pretty determined because they felt they could match Chelsea, so they're pretty keen to have another crack at them.
Chelsea for mine.
Yeah, I'm going to go with Chelsea comfortably. I think it'll be a pretty fair shellacking at Chelsea today, especially like Black has said, that weather's not going to be too bad today, so it is a good day for Curtis Bywater and James Brayan.
Yeah, if Chelsea want to get that top 3 spot there, they obviously have to win today's game.
Yeah, well, obviously being equal on 44 points with Coringle. Coringle go to Hastings today. So we'll go straight into that game, boys. Why not? Hastings hosting Coringle. Mm. Hastings starting to... they're playing some inconsistent footy, aren't they? It looked like they started to come back with Sean Foster coming back into the side. They were getting some good wins on the board.
He didn't play after half-time on the weekend.
No, I heard that, yeah.
Yeah, so he went off before half-time and didn't reappear.
And obviously Matty Clifford with...
Clifford went down the week before. Yeah. And then Ferraro, and so guys like Ferraro, Rogash was well held last week.
Yeah,
too.
Apparently Mitch Cuthbert did an absolute brilliant job.
Did a really good job
Rogash.
On him. And then Coringle have probably lost a few. Farrelly and Buddhahurst.
Yeah, well, Buddhahurst and Farrelly definitely.
What happened
play.
With Hood?
It wasn't really something that we saw in play. I think it must have been behind play, that's for sure.
Yeah.
I think I saw him and Hughesy in a little bit of a tiff, so I think Hughes has given him one
behind
play and split him up in his cheekbone. I spoke to Brett Dunn at halftime and he said he had a fair bit of soreness through the first half, but was happy to play on. Pain just got a bit too much in that second half.
So he hasn't fractured his cheek or anything like that? Or?
I think it's just 4 stitches.
Correct.
Yeah,
just stitches, I believe. Yeah.
Gee, 4 stitches.
Well, no one's as tough as you, Blackers. No one's as tough as you. But I'm surprised Buddhahurst. It'll be interesting to see if he does run out today because he is a tough unit, Buddhahurst. So, coming up against Hastings, you'd think that he'd probably try and get up for his side and have a good crack at it. But then again,
especially he spent a bit of time down there at Hastings and. The Alanis and
maybe
Dunny.
Maybe he's afraid of getting opened up again. There'll probably be a couple of stray elbows being thrown.
Well, I think it's a big game for Hastings. And like I said earlier, I just think that they're going to really struggle to win a game. I think that even though it's Hastings...
This is going to be the easiest one for them coming out.
Well, I think so. Yeah, they've got Red Hill at Red Hill. They've got Chelsea at Chelsea, haven't they?
So I think hosting
at home.
An injured... Coringle. I think it's probably going to be their best opportunity to keep that gap on Langmoreland, that's for sure.
Yeah, and if they win today, game's over. Yeah. Langmoreland's got no chance.
Yeah, exactly right. So there's going to be, obviously Langmoreland will be definitely relying on Hastings to lose. I think Hastings might be good enough today. I think they know what they're playing for, and I think Coringle are just too far from their best side on the park, so I think Hastings might get the job done just over Coringle today. Yeah.
I think Coringle might win, Locke. I think Coringle. I think it'll be a pretty even game all day. I just think that Coringle might have a little bit more.
Yeah, Coringle beat Hastings by 33 points last time, early in the season. And Andy Mathers, he was really good in that game, and he's had a really good season.
He was brilliant on the weekend.
Yeah, he's been very consistent. And the young guys last time, Nathan Villella and Blake Simpson, were really good in their win against Hastings earlier in the season. But early in the season when Coringle did beat Hastings, Matt Stanley kicked 5, and he's not playing. He's still out injured. So
he won't play today?
No, I don't believe so. Danny said probably next week or the week after. Yeah, so that changes things a little bit.
It does, yeah. And they struggled last week, Locke, to kick goals, didn't they?
They did.
I think after half-time they only kicked one or none.
They kicked one goal.
Yeah.
Yeah, they kicked one goal in the third quarter and then didn't score again. Goal wise, it's been an avenue that they're really struggling with, especially with Butterhurst, possibly missing today. I know Blake Simpson played in the twos last week, so whether he gets back into the ones or not, I'm not too sure. For me, Hastings will get the job done just purely because they've got a lot to play for at that fifth spot, and I think Coringle are just too far injured. Boys, we'll go to Jermana. This is the Division 2 match of the round, that's for sure. Jermana hosting Red Hill. It's probably it is a top-of-the-table clash. Obviously, there's 10 points separating them both on the ladder. But Red Hill were down by 50 points at one stage in that game up at Red Hill.
Queen's birthday weekend game earlier on the Sunday. And they got off to a flyer, Locke.
They did. Jermana took off. They kicked. They got 8 goals in front early. And you'd probably just about say that it was game over. And I think they put the fork in the rack and Red Hill flew over the top.
Jamie Mollo, I remember he said on that occasion their fitness proved the difference. He reckons their fitness really told in that crucial last quarter and allowed them to run over the top of Jermana. So interesting. So we'll see if that's the case today again.
Yeah, and look at Jermana love playing their ground really well. But I think today Red Hill would maybe get Michael Mock back from the Frankston Dolphins. He hasn't played for a few weeks. Sean Marchetti hasn't been playing, so with a bit of groin soreness.
Danny Alsop didn't play.
No, he played at Frankston last week. So they've still got a couple of ins. And just like Jermana, I think Jermana, Ethan Johnson come back in last week.
Obviously Sean Clark will be out for a bit with that shoulder.
Yeah, and he'd be about the only one, wouldn't he, Locke?
Yeah, I'd imagine so.
They wouldn't be far off. Both sides, give or take one or two blokes this time of the year.
Tell you what I didn't know, Blackers. Cade Williams is back playing in the twos for Jermana.
Is he?
He's played the last 3 or 4 weeks.
Really?
I forgot to mention that last week. I saw him against Langmoreland 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Pretty handy player to have running around in the twos.
God, yeah.
And so is Matt Hammond. He's playing twos.
Matt Hammond played his first game last week.
Good player. And Reece Wilde's close to coming back. He played in the twos last week as well. So there's another option for him.
A real wild card.
Oh, very punny, Blackers. Very funny. Not bad from you.
Boom, boom.
As we've spoke about
Ish
all
Fossey
year.
Was here today.
He would have liked that. That big grin would have been on his face. He's working late. I think he's at the call centre a bit late tonight. Okay. Vossi. So, as we've spoke about all year, boys, Jermana they've had enough numbers to choose from already, but to have Cade Williams come back through the twos, and you're going to get Reece Wilde come back, Matt Hammond come back. Whether Matt Hammond can put the rest of the season together or not, we're not sure.
And he's got to force somebody else out, and most of the guys are playing pretty good jobs at the moment, or playing well. There's a lot to like about it, and it's going to be a great day. No wind down there at the Pier Street ground, and I think you could flip a coin, at home, I think you just got to go with Jermana. They've been the most consistent side all year, and I think that they'll get themselves up for this game.
Yeah, well, you can't imagine Chris Irving. I mean, for if you look at Red Hill's point of view, you can't imagine Chris Irving and Ben Hughes kicking only one again.
No.
They'll probably have a better game. There's not often that...
Smythe will get one of them, will he? Or
I wouldn't have thought so. I would have thought Gertz probably went to Irving, but I can't imagine Irving will play a key forward for three quarters again like he did against Coringle.
Yeah.
It'll be interesting to go to see who goes to Hughes. I'd assume it'll be the fella from Oakley that they picked up. So it'll be interesting. I think it's William Gregson, I think his name might be. He did the job on Murphy a couple of weeks ago.
He'll probably get the job on
Hughes. Probably go to Hughes. It shapes up to be an interesting contest, that's for sure. Yeah. I think I'm with you, Blackers. I think just purely because... Dramana play their home ground a little bit better because it is that
a little bit smaller
and tighter than what Red Hill is. I don't think it'll allow Red Hill to play their full footy, so I think Dramana might get the job done.
I'll go a little bit different. I'll go for Red Hill. Just they've beaten them once this season, so why can't they do it again?
Yeah, that's right. And look, it's very hard to keep consistently. You know, when you look at maybe four times they might play each other for the year. I remember. Back in the late 90s, we had to beat Crib Point for the fourth time to win a flag, and it's bloody hard.
Yeah, God, it's a lot of times to play one side.
Yeah, because each time they get closer and closer.
Yeah, yeah, they work each other out.
Yeah,
and then find out exactly the way they play, and I guess it's just going to come down nearly almost to what grounds they play on come finals time.
Yeah, that's right. That's why I think that it should be on a. I think Rye's a good ground. You know, it's interesting. It's interesting that Hastings has got one. Look, guys, last year Hastings got found guilty for going over the salary cap and all that sort of stuff, and this year that the league has rewarded them by giving them a home final. Or not a home final, but finals venue. So.
Yeah, and obviously Milesy spoke to us last week about them finally... being able to pay their senior players.
Yeah, that's right, which is great.
Heard a rumour last week that they're still playing their under-19s to play footy.
Are they really?
Yeah.
Like I said, like last week, I think that there's a review getting done. Simon, you should do some homework on that because down the Western Port Peninsula, clubs are struggling. They really are.
Yeah, Milesy touched on that last week, didn't he?
We talked about that last week. And last week I touched on that. A bit of a frog in my throat, you know. Anyway, yeah, something to look about, Simon. So,
yeah, just on today, I was speaking to Ricky Johnson. He's really looking forward to today's game. He says they're a little bit flat. He says today's exactly what they need, you know, a bit of finals intensity and a really good hit out against a quality side. So Terry Wheeler's been playing really good footy all season for Dramana, as you'd expect. He's a quality player. And Rory Grigg in the ruck's been fantastic as well.
So he and Winpope will be good battle.
It should be a good contest. It's funny that you say Rory Grigg's been playing good footy. He has been over the last month or so, but, you know, just over probably 6 weeks ago he was playing in the twos. He got dropped to play through the twos. So, I mean, it just tells you, you know, that it's really good to see that those players, and you know, they might get dropped or they might have been playing twos all year, but when they're coming up to the ones, they're really grabbing their opportunities.
Role. Yeah, and they're buying in, lock, you know. And, you know, when you look at Coringle and Paxton, he obviously didn't want to toe the line with Dunn. So good luck to him. Like, I think it's good that Dunny stood his ground. And
oh, you've got it. As a senior coach.
And as a club.
You've really got to put
more
that
so
forward.
The club.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But Dramana as well, Jay Hutchison played in the ones last week. From all reports, he basically did his knee and it should have been a season-ending injury. I think it was probably a month ago now, maybe over a month ago. He's got a torn PCL from all reports and he's getting around playing in the ones.
Yeah.
Blokes do desperate things, don't they, when they can, you know, smell a possible premiership.
Yeah,
you don't want to miss out.
Yeah,
you know, so good on him.
Yeah, it's pretty tough to if rumours are true, it's pretty tough to play through that. Boys, we'll go to Devon. Devon in some pretty good form as of late, thanks to the RPPFM team for getting Glenn Mickey in. He's taken off ever since we've had him in the studios.
What have they won? Have they won two out of the last three or something?
Yeah, they
like
only
that?
Just missed out on beating Pearstar when they had Drew Petrie.
Yes.
And then they went up to...
Summy?
They went to Summy and
they had
Summy at home and beat Summy quite comfortably.
Yeah.
And went up to Rye on the weekend and beat
Rye.
So from an inconsistent year, it's good to see him putting some solid performances. And
they've only won five games, though, haven't they, Locke?
They have. They're only on 20 points. They're equal. They're equal with Somerville in eighth position. But
it's the same as what happened last year, too.
Yeah.
You know, Somerville, Devon, Piercedale, Tyabb and Crib Point are still the bottom five sides from last year.
Mm.
Yes, we've had a bit of a change at the top, but it's only the sides that have come down from Peninsula. And the other three sides of the...
That were already up in the top for the...
In
the band division. Yeah.
But having said that, I mean, I think Devin Munro's, the coaching job would be pretty attractive to somebody who wants a good challenge, because they've got the basis there, haven't they, of a good future, you know, with a bit of tweaking and a couple of recruits. Yeah.
They really need to continue to work hard on their juniors, and the big growth area in the corridor out there at Cranbourne, they need to be able to tap into that area and get those kids over the line, because if they go to the Yarra Valley, it would be wonderful.
Might have been massive for
Devon Meadows.
For Devon Meadows, because
I think so.
None of the kids are going to want to drive up to
that
far to that competition.
That should
definitely be a recruiting
point.
That's
a real win for them.
Especially if they can get a couple of wins coming home, starting to play some consistent footy.
Now, today, David Cook's 200th game for Crib Point today.
Oh, good on him.
So, well done to him. He's been a great servant. He's been through the ups and the downs, so good on him. They're pretty keen to win for David Cook today.
Yeah.
Well, and if they can put a performance on the park like they did last week...
Well, that's what they've got to do.
...against Piercedale. I mean, they've just got to... from here on in, they've got to take every opportunity they can. You said you spoke to the coach through the week, and he's got quite an upbeat, positive outlook on the rest of the season.
Yeah, absolutely. And Tim Cook played on Theo when they beat Devon Meadows, and he'll have the job again on an informed Theo, so that'll be a good challenge for Tim. And Jacob Cook last time was fantastic running off half-back, so he's another... one to watch today.
All right. Is there any other Cooks there? Or?
Oh, there are.
Yeah. There's plenty of Cooks that get around there.
Absolutely.
They've got their fair share. They're pretty good at breeding the families to the Crib Point. I think the Wiltons play there as well.
I think it's good. Pretty handy. I think if they can put an effort in like they did last week, they'll be right in the game. But I think Devon Meadows really play and understand their ground really well. I can't see that Devon Meadows dropping this one again.
No, me either. Not with the consistent footy they've been playing over the last couple of weeks. I think
especially when you've got guys like Murray, Theodorus, Fletcher. Harms has been playing well in the back line.
Boomgartner.
Boomgartner. He's another good on-field.
They're going. Look, I watched them in that Drew Petrie game, and I was really impressed with Devon Meadows. I thought they had really good spirit. And since then, they've won games. So, yeah, I'd have to go with Devon Meadows today pretty confidently.
Yep, I'm with you, boys. I think Devon Meadows will get the job done over Crib Point. Let's hope that Crib Point can put on the performance they did against Piercedale and really go to Devon Meadows with a bit of competitive footy today. Fingers crossed. We'll then go to Sammy, boys. Sammy, host Rye. Straight off the bat, Simon, we'll throw to you, mate. You had a chat to Somerville this week and you've got some news on Andreas Everett.
Yeah. So Somerville, they've put a working group together headed by Sean Graff, the former Australian cricketer, who's a life member at Somerville Footy Club. And I think he played in a premiership at Somerville. But
he played in the premiership when Gary Colling coached.
Yep.
And that was 82 or something.
That's right. So Graffy loves the club. Yeah, and everybody knows that. And he's a real supporter. He gets down and watches games. But he's heading up a working group to sort of assess the Eagles' season, look at their list, look at their coaching structure and how it's going. He and a few others are going to make some recommendations how the club can move forward into the future. So, and that will pretty much... So Andreas Everett's future, I believe he wants to coach next season, and I think it'll probably hinge on these recommendations that this group gets back to the club, to the committee. So, yeah, it's going to be interesting times. So...
Look, it would be hard for him too. He does travel from Yarraville, I think, So even if they look at, in some sort of a way, getting some people and support around there for him, that's what I'd be doing. I'd be not wanting to try and lose him as a player.
I think they tried. There was a suggestion earlier in the season or before the season that they might get Jimmy Messina, the Pines champion player, league medal winner. I think there was a suggestion he could come on board and help out on the bench, but it never happened. But, you're right. he just needs a bit of support, possibly.
Of course you do. Yeah.
I mean, great player. They want to hold on to him as a player, won't they?
Yeah, that's for sure.
And that next year will be his third year in the competition. So, you know, it takes time for these AFL
to adapt. Yeah, that's for sure. I mean, a player like him, he's got that X factor about him, and I'd certainly be looking to keep him as a player.
Yeah. And, you know, the future of Tim McGinnis, I know there's a bit of interest from clubs in Tim McGinnis. He's a star player.
I've heard that there's multiple.
So Somerville will have to work hard to hold on to Tim.
Well, and you think if Tim went, there'd probably be a couple of others that would go as well. Billy Ruff
would be very close with that connection.
Yeah, I think Adrian Speedy's pretty close with them as well, so you question him. So there'd be a couple that.
A lot of work to be done there at Somerville, especially because the last 2 years they've finished middle of the road, and those guys that you all mentioned would want a bit more success than what they've been having.
Well, especially, I mean, some of them have been outlaying a fair bit of money to have those players at their club, and I know they were extremely disappointed last year not to make the finals, and obviously they're definitely not going to make it this year. So, I mean, they've got to have that group in to really look at the way they're going, because they're outlaying a fair bit of money for those players to not have the result.
And they play Rye today, and that was their best win. That was a fantastic win when they beat Rye down there. They came from behind in the last quarter.
That was the day Everett hurt himself.
Yeah.
And Tommy Roberts, their ruckman.
Yeah.
That was the best game I've probably watched all year. Mm. That was our man of the our match of the day. And
the fat lady sang early, didn't
he? Oh, that's right, Vossie. Yeah.
Voss was. I wish he was here so I could get into him again, but he was all over Rye being home.
At that stage, you would have said,
"Oh mate, it was
I
in
would
my
have
head."
Agreed, yeah.
It was knocking at the back, of my head. I was just smart enough not to say anything.
Yeah, now you can just hang it on him for.
And old Fossey had about five Somerville supporters sitting next to the van, and I tell you what, when they kick goal after goal, they were into him. Fossey was getting every single bit of what they had to say. And me and Shortpass were sitting in the box next to him, letting him have it as well. That's for sure. But
good.
I mean, like you said, Sam, it was an absolute awesome win for the Somerville Football Club. It was the best game I've watched this year, and I mean, they've got the potential to get another win on the board at home today.
Yeah, and I think Rye would be looking for a win here too, liking just trying to keep Summy a little bit behind them. They're a game clear at the moment, Rye, on 24 points, and I think Summy at home, you always back them in. I think that they play their ground pretty well. Unfortunately for Rye, I think their lack of goal kickers, they're struggling down forward.
Yeah, well, it's just too much of a workload on Kirkwood, isn't it?
He can't do everything.
Yeah, they miss Tom Baker, don't they? Unfortunate.
And Brady Egan.
Yeah. But Kirkwood, I mean, they want him to win the ball out in the midfield. They want him to kick five goals. Yeah.
They want him to save five goals from the back line.
They want him to go and play on Luke Rowe at full forward as a full back.
Billy Rolfe will get away from, I think that, might get away from a couple of them today. Speedy's been in really good form. Justin Allsop is playing some good footy as well. Sedgwick is pretty reliable down there.
He's a great swingman, Benny Sedgwick. Yeah. He's probably one of the best swingmans in the competition.
Yeah.
He's either centre-half back, centre-half forward, or in the ruck. And
so they need
Gillis as well. Gillis is playing some brilliant footy.
You know, when you name all those guys, they've got a good nucleus of a side. They need to top up. They've got wonderful kids. Probably get some structure in place, and they should be able to move forward.
Yeah, I think Summy might get the job done today as well, Blackers. I think just purely because they play their home ground pretty well, and they'll want to draw even with Somerville with Ryan and try and get themselves a bit further up the ladder. I think their top end players are better than Ryan's top end players, and they might get the job done.
Yeah, I've tipped Rye. I'm not quite sure why, but I'm going for Rye just to be different.
Yeah, you'd like to be different today.
Yeah, Billy Rolfe's had a good season. He's kicked 34 goals.
Especially considering he was out for, two or three weeks
with
that collarbone.
There was a period where he did his collarbone and missed multiple games. So
good season.
Yeah, it is a really good, especially as a player his size.
He's only a small forward.
And doesn't have some, bulk and strength about him either.
He's just agility-wise.
Yeah, he's been brilliant for Sammy.
Nimble.
Nimble, unlike yourself, Tony.
That's right. I was never nimble.
So that rounds out today's games, boys. It shapes up to be some brilliant games across the board. Obviously, Hastings hosting Coringal. That should be interesting, especially in the context of that fifth spot with Tyab playing or hosting Langwarrin. They're in some good form, and Langwarrin need a win to keep their hopes alive of making finals. So we look forward to our 5 o'clock and seeing those results, that's for sure. Please stay tuned for the Division 1 football show. The boys behind the cameras, thanks for doing what you do. And of course, Simon McAvoy, Tony Blackford for joining me. This is the Division 2 Bendigo Bank football show.